Malaika, nakupende malaika. Malaika, nakupende malaika. Nami ni fanyeye, ikwana wenzio.
Welcome to Africa for the Africans. I'm your host, Shaka Barak, president of the Marcus Garvey Institute. We are filming here at the 110th Street Business Building inside of the Media Center. Now, before you meet our guest and we start our topic, let us get our attitude together with positive affirmations from the Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey. We believe that our history is as good as that of any other race or people, and nothing on this side of heaven or hell will make us deny it. The false treaties, essays, speculations, and philosophies of others notwithstanding, we believe that Africans are direct descendants of the greatest and proudest race who ever peopled the earth. And it is because of the fear of our return to power in a civilization of our own that may outshine others while we are hated and kept down by a jealous and prejudiced contemporary world. We will always claim and prove that the black race was great with status. We will never yield to any statement of our inferiority. We believe that God and nature made our race perfect, that there is no race better than we are, that we have all the elements of human perfection, and as such, we love ourselves. We will never swallow what the white man or woman writes or says about us. We will never admit that the black man or black woman is more immoral than non-Africans, and we will prove the contrary. We will think of our race in the highest terms of human living. Our entire obsession is to see things from our racist point of view. I hope that inspired you. Now, we have a special topic and a special guest for our viewing audience this evening. Now, let me ask you in the viewing audience a question. What is it called when referring to the power exercised by juridically independent territorial entities, which excludes external powers from their domestic internal territories? I'll give you a hint. The Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey, founder and first president general of the UNIA 100 years ago, referred to it as nationhood and the building of a racial empire. You ready for the answer? The answer is sovereignty, a foundational concept of nationalism. The expert here to discuss it with us is one of the researchers extraordinaire, and we will look at not only his ideas in this area, but we will look at some books that he's authored. Let me give you some information about this great brother. It has been said by researchers that he is a man with the rare qualifications of having 29 years of direct African experience. His consulting initiatives include projects with the United Nations, the Economic Community of West African States, the Economic Commission for Africa, various African ministries, members of the U.S. Congressional Black Caucus, members of the National Basketball Association, and various athletes and entertainers. In 2003, our guest published the political book called, and I'll show you, Pan Sovereignty, Sharpen Black Perspectives on Americanization, Africa, War, and Reparations. And as you know, you can put something in the pawn shop, but if you have a ticket, you can get it out. The next book that he's written, this was in 2009, it's called The Sovereign Evolution, Manifest Destiny from Civil Rights to Sovereign Rights. And this book was also listed as one of the 24 best black books in the year 2009 in which it was published. Now, our guest is Professor Aharon, and Ezra Aharon is not the first to discuss sovereignty with Africans, but his books are the first scholarly and comprehensive works that apply the concept and consciousness of sovereignty as a lens to examine the historical and future development of Africans in America. And Ezra Aharon follows in the tradition of great thinkers and men of action like Paul Cuffey, Martin Delaney, Nat Turner, Marcus Garvey, Noble Drew Ali, Elijah Muhammad, Rabi Ben-Ami, leaders of the Republic of New Africa, just to name a few. Now, while he is not trying to get everybody to practice and participate in the sovereign movement, he is trying to make us aware of sovereignty on a conscious level. So, you disciples of those leaders I named, you followers of those great movements that I mentioned, now it is time to raise your consciousness about the science of sovereignty through the writings of Ezra Aharon. Would you welcome our guests, please?
Thank you so much, brother.
Wait a minute.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Great to be here.
Ezra, you know, this is the fourth time I've interviewed you this year. And I really enjoy it because it answers the questions that we as Garveyites and Pan-Africanists have been asking. And that is, how do we upgrade, update the strategies or information so that we can pursue the goals of our great leaders and teachers? So would you begin by telling us, what is sovereignty?
Well, I deal with the concept of sovereignty as it relates from a working definition taken from the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy. And the reason why I do that is because sovereignty has a lot of different definitions, many different applications. So if you talk about sovereignty in different circles, depending on the people, depending on their orientation, that would determine the way the discussion will unfold. And so from a African-American perspective, I began to research the concept and the consciousness in terms of how the concept self-applies to the historical experience of Africans since arriving in America, as well as the future potential development that sovereignty can be used in terms of dealing directly with issues that stubbornly still persist in many ways that time nor legislation has been able to resolve since emancipation. So being faced by so many issues that we know, one, are man-made issues, but two, still unresolved, it made me begin to research, well, what could lie as the anchor or the source of these issues, and what would lie as a potential means of solution-orientated approaches to deal directly with those issues. And so the definition that I use from the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy, it states that sovereignty is a modern notion of political authority that's expressed on two levels, in political thought and two practical institutions. And so understanding that foremost, sovereignty deals with thoughts, with a thought process. You don't actually see sovereignty. What you see are products and symbols of sovereignty. So when you see a government or you see currency or you see constitutions, those in and of itself represent products and symbols of sovereignty. And those products and symbols are things that directly relate to addressing the political and ideological self-identity and self-interest of people. So without having a sovereign consciousness, without having sovereign ideals, then it leads one to become open to the various strengths and the various agendas of others who may perhaps have self-indulgent agendas that they would perhaps pursue at the human and material expense of others. And so I would say, in an encapsulated way, many of the issues that African Americans face today result as a direct consequence of being an unsovereign people. The practical institutions that I mentioned, that is the second level of sovereignty, along with the political thought. The practical institutions, those are the vehicles that are developed in order to deal directly with issues that confront people, that are designed specifically so that the most pressing issues, as well as the self-interest of a people, as well as their ideals, are brought forth on a world stage in conjunction with the other sovereign community of nations, whereby in parallel you have this great community of nations today that we know of and respect as independent nations.
Well, Brother Ezra, you mentioned some unresolved issues, some problems that still persist. And it makes me think about the fact that we are 150 years out of slavery. We then did another 90 years in Jim Crow. Mm-hmm. So we've really basically had our head above water for about 50-something years, and yet some problems still persist, as if the legacy of slavery continues. I know that we have a lot of discrimination, disenfranchisement that is taking place, incarceration of our men and women in the through the prison industrial complex. Now, let me ask you whether or not the ideas of sovereignty are also good for Africans anywhere they are in the world.
Well, Africans on the continent of Africa, being independent, having their own independent nations, I would say that they are at a stage where their sovereignties must be strengthened. All sovereignty is not equal. There's no such thing as sovereign equality. Nations that are more able these days to transform their economic might, their technological capabilities, into political ends and into means whereby they're able to advance their self-interest as well as defend themselves internally are the nations that reside at the top of the pecking order of power of nations today. And within each nation, where you have highly industrialized nations, you find that there are pecking orders of people that reside within those states. You know, in America, there is a pecking order, and always has been a pecking order of people. So you find in the world community of nations that same system of hierarchy exists. And so when you compare African states to European states, you'll see vast differences. First of all, European states are far less populated than African states. And European states, Western Europe, is far more smaller than territorial Africa. And so you'll find that Europeans, although they're much smaller in number and much smaller geographically, they have just as many or more sovereign states in Europe as they do in Africa, each in the 50s. But Africa, the lower 50s, Europe, Western Europe, the higher 50s, but you have smaller populations of people, but yet they have the greater in greater sovereign powers that they're able to exercise. So even though Africa has more people, the sovereign powers of Africa far less. And so when you're examining these things, you have to ask yourself, well, why? How is it that such a small amount of people in a smaller amount of territory can govern and have so much more power in the world politically, economically, and even ideologically than continental Africa?
Now, I'm going to have Ezra answer that. Mm-hmm. But I want to, the reason I asked this question about the lingering legacy of colonialism, the lingering legacy of slavery, chattel slavery, mm-hmm. is that these problems are persisting both on the continent throughout the African world. Let me give you an example. In South Africa, the Economic Freedom Fighters manifesto says that, because they're celebrating 20 years of so-called independence. It says, 20 years later, black people are still not free. 20 years later, black people are still trapped in squalor, unsafe and unhealthy conditions. 20 years later, the black majority is still trapped in landless, homeless, and hopelessness. 20 years later, young and old workers are still subjected to slave wages and dangerous working conditions in the mines, farms, factories, retail stores, and other workplaces. 20 years later, domestic workers and farm workers still work under conditions without basic workers' rights. And lastly, 20 years later, and that's not all of them, of course, but 20 years later, black people battle to survive financially, trapped by debt and often blacklisted by credit unions. Inside of America, inside of South and Central America, inside of the Caribbean, we have this lingering legacy of colonialism and slavery. And I want to know, can sovereignty, the idea of sovereignty, exist in these places, and so that we may end up having to get this book published in Yoruba for Africans and get it published in, you know, Spanish for those Africans, people of African descent, and those Afro-Latinos, you might have to get it published in French for our African brothers and sisters that read French. It seems like this might be beneficial as a way of at least understanding the alternatives and the options wherever African people are.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the measures that you could use to determine whether a nation is developmental or whether it's underdeveloped is what these countries do with their garbage. You can get off of the plane in Africa in any capital city and just drive a few miles and somebody's burning garbage. You won't go to European nations and in the capital cities drive 5 miles outside the airport and find people burning garbage. But in Africa, garbage is a problem. But garbage can be a solution because things can be recycled. So when you're talking about strengthening sovereignty, it affects you on all levels because technology is a part of the world today that's not going anywhere. And so in terms of strengthening sovereignties, as I was making the point earlier, African governments must find ways in order to take advantage of the natural environment that they exist in and turn that environment into things that are going to be beneficial socially, economically, politically, and so forth. Because as Marcus Garvey said, what one man has done, another can do. And so it's not solutionless for Africa to solve its problems, but it's by means of understanding, because one of the things about sovereignty in a collective sense is it brings people to a common understanding ideologically and a common understanding of what objectives should be outlined in order to deal with specific problems. And so that's why one of the things that I do is I outline the specifics of what a sovereign consciousness is all about and what the results of sovereign consciousness can bring about. Because in America, you'll find that even though the word is not mentioned, you don't find that part of the vocabulary being exercised where, you know, you hear the word quite commonly. So, but America, more so than other nations, and I use China as an example of absolute sovereignty, America and China, you'll find that they govern in a way that politically and ideologically they're in many ways insulated. They are able to sustain themselves economically, and they export things to the world, and they economically are powers that other nations in many ways. When you look at the economic structure of the world, you'll see that, you know, European nations now in Western Europe with the European Union, strong internally, when you compare that again against Africa with the African Union, you'll see that, you know, the distinctions are vast.
Well, you know, Brother Ezra, when we think about sovereignty as an option for consideration, there are going to be those in the viewing audience that are going to say, we have civil rights, we have arrived, we are just as happy as we could possibly be, when in fact, one-third of our people are living in abject poverty. And again, the prison industrial complex is working overtime. They're selling stock in prisons in Wall Street. How do we, you know, help our people to understand that when they say that we fought for this country, we died for this country, that now we are entitled to stay here to the bitter end, how do we give them some understanding that there are some possible options? How even human rights doesn't even come up for discussion in this country.
Well, Americanization has been as such that throughout the centuries that we've been here, you've always had people that embraced Americanization. And that is something that for those who wish to embrace it, they have every right and entitlement to do so. One of the things that I always try to emphasize is that by espousing sovereignty, there's always been a segment of Africans in America who's done so. But that should not be viewed as a competing ideal with Africans who want to pursue Americanization, because both can technically coexist. One does not necessarily cancel out the other. And you'll find today that you talk about African Americans or Africans in America, you know, are we really a people? Because I would argue that because of class, whether it's class divisions in consciousness, whether it's religious, whether it's Democrat versus Republican, whether it's ideological, whether it's educational, whether it's economic, you have these different classes of black people. So I would argue that it's very difficult to get everyone on the same page or to get everyone to espouse peoplehood as we once knew it to be. During the times of integration, the color of your, segregation, the color of your skin determined your class. Largely, it didn't matter, you know, what, whether you were Republican or Democrat, whether you had a good job or a bad job, you still couldn't drink white water. So that commonality was clear. But today, the commonalities are not as distinct. So a person who perhaps is working on Wall Street, a person who perhaps is a Democrat would be at odds with someone who's a Republican. So it's very difficult to determine peoplehood. And that's a question. Are we a people? So in my work, I don't in any way attempt to make it appear as though those who aspire Americanization are in effect or by default doing something historically incorrect, because we have equity in this country. Even those of us who would pursue sovereignty or have nationalist ideas that relate to sovereignty still have equity in the country.
So in other words, brothers and sisters in the viewing audience, you can get these books. You can feel comfortable in reading this material because it doesn't offend anyone. Is that right?
I'm saying that the ideas are not competing.
Okay. Okay.
And I can show you how the life of Martin Delaney reflected that, because we have a man who fought in the Civil War. He was made a major by Lincoln.
That's right.
He had traveled to Africa and signed agreements with the Yoruba Nation for Africans in America to return to Africa. But yet he was still committed to fighting in the Civil War.
That's a perfect example. Now, in our last few minutes, let's do this. Let's give the viewing audience some contact information so that they can find out how to reach you, so they can get more information about you and your writings.
Mm-hmm. I can be reached on my website at www.ezraspeaks.com. That's Ezra with an H, E-Z-R-A-H, Speaks, S-P-E-A-K-S, EzraSpeaks.com. You can read excerpts from my book. You can read articles that I've written and read a wide variety of works. And all of that is available at the site, and you can link to my publisher, Author House, to purchase books.
Now, let me also let you know that you can reach us at the Marcus Garvey Institute at 708-613-5132. I'll repeat, 708-613-5132. And brothers and sisters, this is just part one. You know, we've got to have this brother back so that we can continue to talk about sovereignty and talk about the great writings that he has produced. Let us have some closing remarks for our viewing audience in this segment.
Mm-hmm. Well, with sovereign evolution, we have to understand that from the days of emancipation up to segregation to integration, from Harriet Tubman to Dr. King to Barack Obama, the freedom of Africans in America has been part of a continual evolution of progressions. And one of the things that sovereign evolution does is places freedom within that context of forward movement, forward evolution, and places freedom and places ideas within a 21st century context that uses sovereignty as that lens to be the measure, to be the standard of what we use to determine the steps we need to take to move forward.
So we'll be becoming more familiar with the works of Ezra Aharon and sovereignty, to see it as an option that is not necessarily in conflict with the other options that are available. Sometimes I think what will end up happening is that people will gravitate toward those people of like minds, and they'll get it done because you can't really wait for all the lights, the traffic lights, to go downtown before you proceed. Some people will just have to take the initiative and go ahead and get things started. But if you're going to look at the alternatives, why don't you get the best material that is available today, cutting edge material on this subject, because again, it goes so does so much to help educate us about the strategies of many of our great leaders. But now we have information of modern information in our hands. I want to thank you for being on Africa for the Africans.
Thank you.
Please stay tuned. We will have this brother back. We're going to do a part two. You don't want to miss it, brothers and sisters. Thank you for listening to Africa for the Africans. I'm your host, Shaka Barak, and we will see you real soon at our next session of Africa for the Africans.